climb mountains if the mountains were where you hide. Oh, how far I'd scale the valleys if you grace the other side. Oh, how long have I chased rivers from lowly seas to where they rise? Against the rush of grace descending from the source of its supply. 'Cause in the hurtings and the heartache, you're neither more or less inclined. I would search and stope in nothing, you're just not that hard to find. I would praise you on the mountain, I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heaven where my heart is, in the highlands and the heartache all the same. Whoa, whoa. Oh, how far beneath your glory does your kindness extend the path? From where your feet rest on the sunrise to where you sweep the sinner's path. Oh, how fast could you come running if just to shadow me through the night and trace my steps through all my failures and walk me out the other side? For who could dare ascend that mountain, that valley hill called Calvary? But for the one I call Shepherd, who like a lamb was slain for me. I will praise you on the mountain, I will praise you in the mountains in my way. You're the summit where my feet are, so I will praise you in the valleys all the same. No less God within the shadows, no less faithful when the night leads me astray. You're the heavens where my heart is, in the highlands and the heartache on the sea. Oh, oh, wherever I walk through, wherever I am, whatever I walk through, wherever I am, your name can move mountains, wherever I stand. If ever I walk through the valley of death, I'll sing through the shadows my song of ascent. From the greatest of all valleys come the pastures we call grace. A mighty hold my religion. I'm laying down. I wanna know you, Lord. I'm laying down. Hold my religion. I'm laying down. I wanna know you, box you in, but I'm laying down. I wanna know you, Lord. I used to think that I could box you in, but I'm laying down. I wanna know you, Lord. I'm laying down. Oh, my religion. cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore, for endless days we will sing your praise, oh Lord our God. And on the third, at break of dawn, the Son of in robes of white, the blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints, my gaze transfixed on Jesus' face. Oh, praise the name of the
morning, Bride Church. It's Resurrection Day, and we're excited to bring the message of the resurrection from this spot. We are here in the Sutter Buttes. You might recognize it, and we're privileged to be able to speak the truth of the gospel here on this property. We want to thank Dan and Teal McCracken and their family for giving us the opportunity to come to you here. Just a minute, few minutes, we're going to go into worship. I just want to ask you to remember, if you could, the communion elements, and if you would prepare those at the end of the service, we'll be taking communion with you. Let's pray. Jesus, Lord, we thank you for your unfailing love. We thank you, Lord God, for your steadfast spirit, Lord. We thank you for your faithfulness. And we pray this morning, Lord Jesus, that you would bring all of those attributes to us this morning, Lord, as we glorify you. And as we camp out around your word and around worship, with our families and our homes this morning, Lord. We pray that your presence would be magnified and that we would edify you this morning and you would just encourage us this morning. Just encourage us this morning with our living hope. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, amen.
Got him on my knees again. Got him begging, please again. I need you. Oh, I need you. Walking down these desert roads, water for my thirsty soul. I need you. Oh, I need you.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ear. It's like holy water on my skin. Dead men walking, slave to sin. I wanna know about being born again. I need you. Oh God, I need you.
So take me to the riverside.
Forgiveness,
it's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips,
like
the sound of a symphony to my ear.
It's like holy water on my skin. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
I don't want to abuse your grace.
God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. Oh,
I don't wanna abuse your wings.
God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me wanna change. Your forgiveness, it's like sweet, sweet honey on my lips, like the sound of a symphony to my ear.
Like holy water.
Your forgiveness, that sweet, sweet honey on my bed, like the sound of a symphony to my.
Thank you.
Today, not in a church building, but you are the church, and we're gonna sing a little bit louder, make our praises loud enough for the entire neighborhood to hear. Why don't you join with me, sing a little louder, louder and louder and louder. We've got nothing to hold back. Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies,
sing louder.
Morning glory, evening grace, Bride Church. Great to be with you. Happy Resurrection Day. He has risen, and I hear back, he is risen indeed. This morning, first we'll begin with a little scripture from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I hope it comforts you in your homes. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us pray awake and be sober. For those who sleep and sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of love and faith and a helmet and the hope of salvation. For God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with them. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. And yes, we need to keep doing that. We need lots of encouragement with what's going on, don't we? So let's bow our heads now, everybody in your home, and let's pray over this morning's offering. Father, we come before you in strength, Father, in strength because we know who you are and we believe and keep your promises. Father, as we beseech you this morning, we ask for your protection. We ask for your healing for the whole world. And Father, we would pray for a filling of faith, hope, and love. And Father, that our faith would not grow dim in all of this tragedy that we see around us. And Father, that our hope would not grow cool. And Lord, that our love, Father, would endure forever because we are in you and with you. And you are keeping us. You have a hold of us. And you will never, never let us go. So, Father, we pray for the sick, especially in our congregation. We pray, Lord, that you protect the elderly. And, Father, we lift them up to you and ask you to guard them. And, Father, we know that this moment of being in virtual reality here is passing. And that our hope, Lord, is that we can gather again, like the scripture says. Father, because there's nothing virtual about your Son. He came to us, Father. He came to us physically and walked among us. And he healed. And he performed miracles. And he obeyed his Father. And he gave up his rights and went to the cross. And so now, Lord, we too must give up our rights to meet because we are called to love one another, to love our neighbor. And so we shall, Father. And we ask that you walk us through this time, Father, and soon we will be back together, and we'll eat from the bread and drink from the cup together once again. So, Father, we pray for this morning's offering. Bless the gift and the giver. And we ask, Lord, that you would just fill our ears and our hearts with Pastor Bob's message this morning. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Generous giving is part of who we are at the Bride Church. Your faithful giving continues to make an impact on our community and beyond. We give as an act of worship, returning to God a portion of what He has entrusted us with. At the Bride Church, we've made online giving easy and secure. You can use our app for an easy link to give online, or go to thebridechurch.org/give and click or tap on the Give button. Once you're there, you can select credit or debit, or use your bank information for an electronic check. After you've filled out your information, there are options to cover the processing fees or set up recurring payments with automated giving. To make things faster next time, select Remember Me and enter a password and PIN number to secure your account. It's that easy. As always, you can still mail a check or set up automated payments with your bank if you prefer. Our address for mailing your tithes and offerings is 1321 Peachtree Lane, Yuba City, California, 95993. Your generosity makes a kingdom impact as we serve our community and world together.
O Lord, how many are my foes? Many are rising against me. Many are saying of my soul, there is no salvation for him in God. But you, O Lord, are a shield about me, my glory and the lifter of my head. I cry aloud to the Lord, and he answered me from his holy hill. The Lord is faithful, and he's just. He carried out his faithfulness on the cross for us, and 3 days later, just like he said, he rose again in glory. So we have the confidence that he lives today. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Let's sing of his faithfulness together.
Great is your faithfulness, oh great, great.
thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Good morning, Bride Church, and others joining us. Happy Resurrection Day. Jesus is risen. Pastor Bob's going to come on shortly with his message of hope found in the resurrection. But first, he invited me to share these truths. Did you know that skeptics, when attempting to discredit the claims of Christianity, attempt to disprove the resurrection of Christ? Have you thought about why that might be? Well, they understand something sometimes better than us Christians, that if Christ did not raise from the dead as he predicted, then all other truth claims of Christianity would be false. Why? Because he stated his resurrection would be the attesting sign as the proof for all his claims and actions. To the antagonistic religious leaders' demand, "Give us a sign," Jesus stated the ridiculous, "You will kill me, and in 3 days I will rise again." Jesus was staking everything on that event, all his claims. And his biggest claim that was make or break was his claim to be God, having the right to forgive sins and to receive worship. I say make or break because if he doesn't rise as he predicted, then he's not God in human flesh as claimed, but just another deluded religious nut or a purposeful, cruel deceiver. His gospel is false. There is no Savior who lived a sinless life, no atoning sacrifice so we could be forgiven. And as the Apostle Paul stated, who understood this, quote, "If Christ has not been raised from the dead, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins." 1 Corinthians 15, the resurrection chapter. The resurrection of Christ is the hinge pin upon which everything else depends. That is why so many skeptics have set out to disprove the resurrection of Christ, only to run into mounds of overwhelming evidence, being convinced otherwise, resulting then in their conversion. In my early days, the skeptic turned believer was Josh McDowell, and his findings, his book, Evidence That Demands a Verdict, and his second book, More Evidence That Demands a Verdict. Did Jesus raise from the dead as he predicted he would? McDowell says the evidence is overwhelming in support of such. "Here's the evidence, now you must decide the verdict," he would say. And close to our time, Lee Strobel, who wrote The Case for Christ, again set out to disprove Christ. While attempting an unbiased approach, as he had been schooled at Harvard to do investigative research, he too converted and has become one of the clearest apologists in our time. So if Christ did rise from the dead and said it would be the sign to verify his claims, do you understand the significance of this and the implication to you personally? His resurrection, as predicted, suddenly highlights and intensifies every other statement Jesus ever made about himself, his Father, about life and death, heaven and hell, how to live, not to live, and what you must do to be saved, and even how to face tomorrow. When Jesus entered into Jerusalem on that donkey, and the Jewish leaders heard the children shouting out, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they indignantly said to Jesus, "Do you hear what these children are saying?" You see, they believed Jesus was accepting a statement of his messiahship. Jesus' answer shocked them, as his claim about himself went much further than just as Messiah. "Yes," he says, "have you never read, 'Out of the mouth of infants and nursing babes, you have prepared praise for yourself?'" He is quoting David's Psalm, Psalm 8, 2. As David is exalting God for the splendor of his name above all creation, listen to this. "O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth, who have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouth of infants and nursing babes, you have established praise." By quoting this, Jesus' reply to the indignant chief priests amounted to an inescapable assertion of his deity. He was claiming the right to receive worship as God. This assertion begins an all-out confrontation with those who want to kill him for such claims. After several days of Jesus answering the leaders' questions in Jerusalem, questions designed, by the way, to trap him, he asks them a question, revealing again that the Christ is more than the Son of David. He is indeed the Son of God. Matthew's account says, "No one was able to answer him a word, nor did anyone dare ask him a question from that day on." By the end of the week, they would answer him by having him arrested, tried, and crucified. But because he is who he said he is, death could not hold him. When Jesus did rise from the dead, all of his so-called ludicrous claims are suddenly hard and fast, undeniable, hardcore truth with eternal implications. Truth that he backed up in the most impossible way. Truth statements like this: "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me." And how about this one? "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even if he dies, and everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." John 11 and John 14 were those passages. I have to stop here with this point. For those who have placed their faith in the risen Christ, his message is an assuring one. He came to give his life as the ransom for our sin. That's his statement. Because he lives, you can rest in the assurance of the forgiveness of all your sin. Because he lives, he has defeated death. And you can rest assured you will defeat death also and live in eternity with him in the fullness of joy. His promise. For those, however, who are still relying upon your own way, your own truth, so to speak, and still expecting to be accepted into heaven on your terms, Jesus warns you otherwise, saying he is the only way, because he is the Son of God sent by his Father to make that way possible. He is that way because he is life itself. The good news is his arms are wide open to you if you will but forsake your own way and exchange it for him and his. You can do that today and need to. And for that person listening today whose sin is so shameful in your mind that you wonder if Christ would ever forgive you and embrace you as his own, the cross shows just how far he would go to demonstrate his love for you. There is no sin that his love and readiness to forgive is not deeper still.
We have hope in Jesus Christ. He is alive. We can trust in him. Worship him today. Let's sing this together. How great the chasm. How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is waiting. Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, that sealed the promise. Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours.
I hope you enjoyed worship as much as I did. My goodness, it's so good to be with family and worship the Lord together. We're going to continue the worship this morning, and we're going to open up the scriptures and let them reveal the truth to us about Easter and what Easter reveals to us. It should reveal to us the resurrection of Christ. You know, I was thinking that all across the United States this morning and all across Yuba City, there's an emptiness. There's a sense of grief, if you will. We're unable to do the things that we normally do. One of them is coming to church on Easter morning with our family. And so there's this emptiness, the kind of a spirit of emptiness that's around us, if you will. And I was thinking about all the things that are empty. The schools are empty. The colleges are empty. The beaches are empty. The restaurants are empty. And yep, even the church this morning is empty. But there's another place that's empty this morning, and it's found in the city of Jerusalem. And of course, by now you know what I'm leading up to, is that in this tomb, it's also empty. This was the tomb that held our Savior, Jesus Christ. And this is the reason why today we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. And I'm excited to pronounce, like all of you have and will later in the service, that Jesus is alive and He is our living hope. I'd like to just share the passages of Scripture that most of the time that we camp out around when we explain or we share the Easter story. This one was explained and shared by Luke, Dr. Luke, found in Luke, one of the Gospels, chapter 23. I'm just going to read a significant amount of Scripture that leads us up to the and into the empty tomb. In Luke 23, starting in verse 52, this man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took the body of Jesus and he wrapped it in a linen shroud and laid it in a tomb cut in stone, where no one had ever yet been laid. It was the day of preparation, and Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed and saw that the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and they prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath day, they rested according to the commandment. So they went to prepare the body of Jesus in this borrowed tomb, and then on the Sabbath day, they rested. Jesus is now completely gone. He has been separated from us, and he is dead. He had, at this point, taken upon himself our sin on a cross and laid himself down for us, and now they laid his body to rest. We continue in chapter 24, verse 1. But on the first day of the week, Sunday, the day that we stand here celebrating, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking the spices that they had prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. But when they went in, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And while they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened, they bowed their faces to the ground. And the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still in Galilee that the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and on the third day rise." This was Jesus' promise to his disciples. He had promised that this was going to happen and told them that he would rise on the third day. And then they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all of these things to the 11 and to all of the rest. And now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. But these words seemed to them just an idle tale, and they did not believe him. But Peter rose and ran to the tomb, and stooping and looking in, he saw the linen cloths by themselves. And he went home marveling at what happened. Today, there's going to be two sides of this empty tomb. One, some will just receive it as an empty tale. And to others, like Peter, they will walk away from the empty tomb marveling at what just happened. You know, the last few weeks we've been talking about how Jesus, as he walked towards the cross, he would always kind of give insight to his followers of his pending death and the reason for his death. As we read, when the angel started talking to the disciples and to those that went to the tomb, he reminded them what was promised. This morning, I want to bring out two things that I feel that the Lord wants us to be given. And they are the power of the resurrection and the hope of the resurrection. Both of those things are available to the believer. And this morning, I pray that our minds and our hearts would be open to receive the power of the resurrection and the hope that's given to the believer through the resurrection. One of the ways that Jesus was encouraging his disciples on the way to the cross is found in John chapter 14, verse 1. Turn there if you will. "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be." Jesus is trying to encourage his followers, knowing that their heart is going to be possibly confused or kind of scattered or disheartened, if you will, at his pending death. And so he says, "Let not your hearts be troubled." The word trouble is an interesting Greek word. It's pronounced terazo. Do not let your hearts be terazoed. Believe in God. So how do we come out of the trouble? By believing in God. The word trouble, it actually means in the Greek uncertainty. It doesn't mean trouble like we would normally think it means, like, uh-oh, I got in trouble. Uh-oh, I'm going to get punished. Jesus is using this word of uncertainty. Don't let your hearts be uncertain, trying to get them to be ready, if you will, for his death. He says, "Believe in God, believe in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you?" In other words, he's not going to lie to them. And he's not lying to us this morning in his word. He says, "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again," another promise, "and I will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." So this morning, if there's any uncertainty in your heart, if there is any confusion in your heart, let the words of Jesus land on that troubled heart. Let not your hearts be troubled. Uncertainty be replaced with hope. There's two words today, the resurrection and the hope. There's two concepts or takeaways that I'm hoping that we can pull from Scripture this Easter morning and this resurrection day to walk with them, that they would encourage us, that they would lift us up, they would change our countenance, they would put a bounce in our step, if you will, as we move forward in these interesting times. He says, "Believe in God." Remember, some of you possibly think that this resurrection or the story of Jesus is a tale. Maybe someone in your family has encouraged you to sit with them this morning and listen to this message. Listen, this is not a fairy tale written by some author. This is the very author and the perfecter of our faith. God himself had a design from the very foundations of the world, and you were in his mind's eye. He wants to take you with him. He wants to come back for you as well. You know, in Ephesians, Paul has this, he has this prayer. He has this heart of prayer as he talks to the church. And the word that he is heading towards is this first word that I want to talk about this morning, which is hope. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints. He wants us to surround ourselves with hope. He wants our hearts to be enlightened, if you will, to hope. These are His riches. These are our glorious inheritances in the saints, a hope to which He has called us to this morning. What is hope? You know, what you think about it, you know, what does that word hope mean? Well, to some of us, at least to me this morning, I told Tony, Pastor Tony, I said, I hope everything works out. And then he reminded me, Bob, what's the message? Yeah, it's a different kind of hope. This message is a different kind of hope. This message is actually to be fully assured of what you hope for. It means to have a confident expectation. Isn't it a word like, I hope it all works out? Hopefully things are going to work out. No, this is a word that is living hope. This is the hope that we have in Christ, the hope that He offers after the resurrection. What is hope? It's found in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 11. But before we start to read some of the concepts and the ideals of hope, if you will, it's important to understand what happens to us when we're hopeless. Scripture says that hope deferred makes the heart sick. If you think about your soul, if it's troubled this morning, then hope is the answer that you need. The hope that is received after the resurrection. The belief on the promise of the resurrection is what we now stand on today. It's a perfected promise. And now we, as we stand here, our hope is not in this place. Our hope is found in Him. If it was dependent upon me or my works or my efforts to be in relationship with God, that would be a hopeless situation. There would be no hope in that. But God offers us another solution. He offers His finished work on the cross. He offers His exchange of our sin and His righteousness. I love that song that my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ and His righteousness. You know, there's what happens to us when we lose hope is some of us, we get sluggish. We slow down. We begin to just ponder too much of the uncertainty, if you will. And right now, I'm telling you, you know, too much news is dangerous to your soul. Too much is just dangerous to your soul. And a lot of hope right now would be really, really good for your soul. So let us just continue. Let us just continue in these passages. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 11, the writer says, "We desire each one of you to show the same earnestness, to have the full assurance of hope until the end." The full assurance of hope. There's the three words, full of hope, and in the middle of that is assurance. And you know, it's like when you say the word hopefully, it's empty. But it's interesting how the two words, hopefully, are together here. Full of hope. Full of hope. What happens to us when we take a hold of this scripture so that we may not be sluggish, but imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises of God? You know, I want you to just listen to me as I read something that came to me this morning. That a hopeful heart is a hope that is full. A hopeful heart is a hope that is full of assurance. It's full of confidence. It's full of expectation. It's full of expectancy. It's not filled with uncertainty. It's full with expectancy of something good. This kind of hope changes our perspective. This kind of hope moves us to rejoice. This kind of hope takes us from a place of sluggishness and causes us to move forward, causes us to see God in the details of the day, that we'd be expecting Him to fill us with His Spirit and to open up our eyes to the full revelation, if you will, of His promises. That God also fills us and moves us so that we can love. He fills us and moves us so that we can love. He fills us and He moves us so that we could serve. You know, also in Scripture, the writer in Hebrews uses a word picture of what hope is. He calls it an anchor. And before I read this Scripture, I want you to ponder yourself on a boat, really calm water, kind of like it was 2-3 months ago. Everything was just right. You're not grabbing your anchor. There's no storm. There's no wandering around and being shifted around in the wind. There's just kind of a steadiness. But anchors are thrown off the side of a boat when storms come or when waves come to hold the boat steady. And the writer in Hebrews in chapter 6, verse 19, says it like this: "We have a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul." Again, a hope that's found in the soul brings great joy. It brings great assurance. We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul. What is he referring to? Comma, a hope that enters in to the inner place behind the curtain. And it's there that Jesus enters in as our chief shepherd, the high priest, in the order of Melchizedek, the scripture says, that he goes in there and he offers intercession for us. He offers, if you will, himself to us, and we can now safely go in with confident expectation that we can let him know what our needs are, that we can let him know that he hears us. There is not I hope he hears me. There is full assurance that God right now hears you. He hears us. He desires to listen to every need that you have. He also desires you to, even in the midst of where you're at, to rejoice in the resurrection, to rejoice that he's alive, to rejoice that he is with us, to rejoice that he is for us, to rejoice. And all of this rejoicing doesn't come on an empty, "I hope so." It comes on full assurance. It comes through faith. It comes through hope. And the ending of it, if you will, is his love. I want to share with you a story that I found recently about Thomas Edison. Thomas Edison was the inventor of the phonograph, the inventor of electricity being transmitted. There's so many things that today, that the technology that we use today was first founded by Thomas Edison. He had a laboratory in New Jersey, and in 1914, his lab caught fire. The whole entire lab, everything that he invested in, all of his formulas, if you will, all of his efforts were burnt up, completely burned. The story continues that it was actually proven and written down that Thomas, as he was looking over the charred remains of all of his works, said these words. His son actually heard him say it, which leaves a whole legacy for his son. He says, "There is great value in disaster. All of our mistakes are burned up. And now I can thank God that we can start again." Oh my goodness. How much hope is found there, you guys. And when I think of that, I think of the hope that comes up out of the grave, that comes up out of this tomb and says, "I'm not here. I'm risen. You know, don't look for me among the dead. I'm alive." This is a living hope. Paul goes on and he tells us in Ephesians, the second half of his prayer, he continues and he says this, and this is the second aspect of the resurrection that I want us to grab a hold of and take away today. In Ephesians 1, 19, Paul continues his prayer. "And what is the immeasurable riches of his power towards us who believe?" What is the immeasurable? We can't even measure the power that is given towards us to those who believe. This would be a really good time right now that the Holy Spirit may be opening your heart. It's only through his grace that a heart is opened. It's only through the calling of Jesus that your heart might be open right now to believe. And to the believer, there is great power given. "According to his great might comes this power that he worked in Christ when he raised his son from the dead." This is the power. This is the power of the resurrection that is given to the believer. Oh my goodness, what a dynamic duo. Hope and the power of the resurrection. Put those two together. You're not going to sit on the couch. You're not going to just sit there and be uncertain. You're going to be full of hope and full of his power. The power that he used to forgive your sin. The power that he used as he raised from the grave, declared himself God, gives you freedom from sin. It's his power that overcome your sin. It's his power of the resurrection that declares your forgiveness. All that he asks you to do is believe. It's the same power that he has given to us to forgive others. It's the same power that he gives us that we can forgive others that sin against us. Listen, you can't do that on your own. You are incapable of forgiving yourself sin. And a lot of us are really incapable of forgiving other people's sin. But this is supernatural resurrection power that he gives us. He also gives us the power to heal our hearts. The resurrection gives help. It gives encouragement to the troubled heart. It gives power to fill us with faith. He gives us the power that we need to fill us with faith. He gives us the power to overcome sin. He gives us an opportunity, a fresh start, just like he did Thomas Edison at the charred remains of your old life. He gives you hope that you can overcome sin. This is really good news to those that struggle, to those that are bound in some kind of a temptation or some kind of addiction. This is really good news that you don't have the power to overcome this, but Christ himself, who has conquered the grave, has given you hope that you can and power that you will. This power is to fill us with the same resurrection power that was used to raise Christ from the dead. You know, today I went to Sutter Cemetery and I walked around out there just for a little while, and unfortunately, I've done lots of services at Sutter Cemetery, and many of your loved ones and many of your friends and acquaintances are buried there. Now, this hope and this power is given to the dead in Christ. This same hope and this same power is given to all who believe. And my father, being one of the men that I buried at Sutter Cemetery, had this hope. His hope was not on his works. His hope was not on his ability to stop doing this or stop doing that. For goodness sakes, that would be hopelessness. His hope was found in Christ. And yes, my dad succumbed to some bit of hopelessness, but the scripture tells us that nothing, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. Nothing. And he did not separate himself from those that are full of hope in Christ, or full of the assurance that there's a better place, there is life after this place. You know that the devil was defeated at the resurrection? How do I know that? Because the same writer in Hebrews says this in chapter 2. Since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, God's children through his Son share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same thing. Jesus, although he was fully God, became fully man, that through his death, he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil. This is really good news to the believer. This is really good news to those of you that might begin to believe right now, that God, through his Son, that was delivered over for your sin, has defeated the devil and the power of the grave. And he's able to deliver all of those from the fear of death, the scripture says, that he could literally deliver you from the fear of death. And I know that many people right now are concerned about this virus or about this sickness. But hope and the power of the resurrection can overcome any fear or any death. Any death. You know, there's this beautiful, beautiful scripture found in Lamentations chapter 3. About the psalm, the one lamenting here was in the place of trouble. And then he cried out to the Lord. He took his uncertainty, if you will, his troubled heart to the Lord. Listen to his scripture. Listen to his words. He declares in Lamentations chapter 3, verse 22, the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. These are promises. This is where our hope is built on. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, and his mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, and great is your faithfulness. Great is your faithfulness. and 24. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. This hope is an anchor for your soul. It's not up in your mind. It's way down deeper. It's in the spiritual side of who you are. And your soul cries out and says, the Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. Therefore, I will hope in him. Listen, there's nothing worse than to see people not be able to bring hope to the bed where someone's about to lose their life. Unfortunately, I've been around a lot of people when they're about to take their last breath. And there's such an assurance to those that have hidden themselves in Christ in that moment or prior to that moment. There's such an assurance for those around. But you know what's absent a lot of times when people are given a bad report and the fear of death might be looming over that household? There's not a lot of people except believers that are willing to walk in that household. Because what are the non-believers going to say? Hopefully, you'll get over it. No. They walk in with a confident expectation. They walk in with full assurance that no matter what, there is life beyond the place that you're at. There's life beyond the cemetery. There is life beyond your circumstances. You know, as we went out to the cemetery this morning, I was reminded of another promise. The promise that God will come back through his son. Matthew 24:7, Jesus is speaking. He says this, for as the lightning comes from the east and shines as far as the west, so will be the coming of the Son of Man. As lightning comes from the east, the Sutter Cemetery is east of us. There'll be a thunderclap and lightning will come and shine as far as the west. So will be the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. At Sutter Cemetery, every one of those tombstones, including my father's and your loved ones, and soon to be yours, unless he comes again, is pointed to the east. Even other religions bury their dead facing east. And one time, this gentleman back in Mississippi, he pointed to me this scripture and said, Bob, this is why the tombstones face east. When Christ returns, another of his promises, hope is found in his return, and the dead in Christ will be raised. God doesn't waste nothing. He's going to take these bodies, even if they have been burned up, and he's going to make them new. That's the power of the resurrection. That is not natural power. That is the power of the resurrection. But it's no coincidence that all of those tombstones are facing to the east. Now as we close and we prepare for communion, I want to give you an opportunity to prepare communion. But I first want to give an opportunity for anyone in your home or anyone listening to this right now to come in to this resurrection power and into this hope, this living hope of Christ. Scripture tells us that we're dead in our trespasses and sins, that we have no hope for peace with God, for eternal life, but we have a solution. The solution was his son took upon himself all of your sin, all of your shame. And the reason why he died wasn't because of bad men put him to death. He says that you didn't take my life, I laid it down for you. He gave himself up. You will not see another human being on the planet willing to take your penalty upon himself and give himself up for you. That's what Jesus has done. But when he went into the tomb, as we read earlier in Luke, he did not stay there. On the third day, just like he promised, he was raised. He rose and he went and appeared to his disciples. And then he ascended to heaven. And he tells us in Scripture that he sends us the Holy Spirit. And right now, I pray that he sends you the Spirit enough open your eyes, open your ears, and more importantly, let your troubled heart be open. No more uncertainty, but blessed assurance that you could say, he's mine. Jesus is mine. Would you do do that right now? Would you just bow your head or keep your eyes open and just believe this in your heart and confess it with your mouth? Just pray with me. Father, I pray that anyone listening this morning would consider this good news of this living hope, this power that's given to those that believe. I pray that they would believe and receive. I pray that they would turn from their unbelief, that they would turn from the direction that they're going. They would repent and they would come to faith in Christ. I pray this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, if you'd like to do that, just pray along with me. Jesus, thank you. Thank you for giving up your life for me. I pray today, Lord, that I would receive by faith this grace, not based upon anything I've done or anything I have to do, but fully based on what you've done. I reach out, just take your hand, if you will. Just reach out, let him grab your hand, and let him save you right now. And in that moment, he fills you with his power, the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. He fills you with the hope beyond this place. He puts a bounce in a step. He puts joy in your heart, and you'll find yourself worshiping Jesus, whom you can't see. But one day, you will. One day, your faith and your hope will become sight. God bless you. If you've received Christ, then tell someone. Tell someone online. Tell someone in that room so we get to know you. That you can join the family of God. That you can join the community of the saints and the believers. God bless you. Now, if you would, let's prepare for communion. Hopefully you have something that you could share communion with us this morning, especially with your family. What a sacred opportunity that we have right now to enjoy the elements, if you will, the symbols of grace, the symbols of his body that was broken. On Good Friday, he had this meal with his disciples. The Friday before his death, he took the bread and he offered it to his disciples and said, "Here, this is my body that is broken for you." He was pierced and striped and broken and wounded and suffered because of our sin. And he tells his disciples in that moment to take and eat. Then he held up the cup of the new covenant, the cup of blood, the cup of redemption, the cup that would be spilt out of his side, of his brow, the blood to redeem man back to the Father, to remit sin, to remove it as far as the east is from the west, and that we would be accounted as one of his very own through the belief and the partaking of Jesus. Let's drink together. We're ready to close now. There'll be one more worship song, but we're going to close with this scripture. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you. May he equip you with every good for doing his will, and may he work in us what is pleasing to him, that through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. God bless you. It's been amazing to be able to stand outside like the rest of you, not inside a building this morning, but suddenly in a place to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ. God bless you guys.
You showed us the power of death is broken. Just one touch and I can change. Your wish, my true name.
taking off my grave clothes, putting on resurrection. Taking off my grave clothes, putting on righteousness. Taking off my grave clothes, putting on resurrection. You step in, crushing every stronghold. Oh my sin, beneath your feet. Just one word, you awaken my soul. I trade these rags for who you say. Sing it till I mean it, till all my doubts have been defeated. I'm gonna sing it till I mean it. You're gonna see this dead man walk. I'm gonna sing it till I mean it, till all my doubts have been defeated. I'm gonna sing it till I mean it. You're gonna see this dead man. I'm gonna sing it till I mean it, till all my doubts have been defeated. I'm gonna sing it till I mean it. You're gonna see this dead man.
Happy Resurrection Day, everybody.
He has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Happy Easter.
Jesus has risen. Happy Easter.
Happy Resurrection Day.
He is risen.
Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever.
He is risen.
He is risen.
He has conquered the grave.
Happy Easter.
He is risen.
He is risen.
Happy Resurrection Day. Jesus has risen.
He is risen? Hallelujah.
Jesus is alive. He has risen.
He is risen. He is alive.
Happy Resurrection Day.
He has risen indeed.
He is risen.
Happy Easter.
Brandon, you want to say something?
Amen.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Happy Easter, everybody.
Happy
Resurrection Day.
Jesus is alive! He is risen!
Happy Resurrection Day.
He is risen!
I serve a risen Savior. Hallelujah!
Jesus is alive! He has risen! I love you, Jesus!
Christ has risen, and He is alive.
Happy Easter! Jesus is alive!
He is risen!
Happy Easter! God bless you all!
Jesus is alive on this Resurrection Sunday.
He has risen and He's in our hearts.
Jesus is alive! He has risen!
Jesus is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He did this for us.
Happy Easter, Bride family.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter from the Hallmarks and...
He is not here, for He is risen.
Happy Resurrection Day.
Jesus is alive.
Jesus is alive and He has risen from the grave.
Happy Resurrection Day.
He is risen.
Happy Resurrection Day.
Jesus is alive.
Happy Resurrection Day.